body regulates its hydrogen concentration and what are some of the clinical conditions that will cause deviation and what are the applications of it within this short period of time that we have. Right? So let's take you back to your O-level chemistry. You all remember this equation in O-levels, the aqueous solution of water dissociated into hydrogen ion and hydroxyl ion. Everyone remembers that, right? Is there anybody that doesn't remember this equation? It's been a while. Alright, what did you come back? Okay? Alright? So this process is usually described by a dissociation constant. You all remember the dissociation constant of water, alright? The KW, right? Which describes the equation of the concentration of the hydrogen ion multiplied by the concentration of the hydroxyl ion, and it's usually about 10 to negative 14. Right? In the blood, blood, the arterial hydrogen ion concentration is normally about 14 millimoles per liter. Actually, that is 14 nanomoles per liter. Please don't pick up that error. You get to go through the slides. Alright, 14 nanomoles, not N, it's N, nanomoles per liter, or 4 times 10 to the power minus 9 millimoles per liter. Okay? That's the concentration, the normal concentration of hydrogen ion in arterial blood. Okay? And the hydrogen ion is more commonly expressed, alright, in clinical medicine, it's very cumbersome for you to be talking about 40 nanomoles or 4 times 10 to the power minus 9. So it is usually expressed as a negative logarithm of its concentration, and which is the pH. Alright? So pH is negative log 40 times 10 to the power minus 9, which is 7.40. So when you look at that on your logarithm charts, okay? So that's 7.40. So that's how we come about 7.40 being the ideal arterial blood pH. Right? Now, a few things that our dissociation constant is usually affected by temperature. And so when you refer to things like pH, you also have to talk about the temperature at which you are referring to that pH, because it changes with temperature. So at a normal body temperature, we're talking about probably about 37 degrees Celsius, then we know that the pH of a normal arterial blood is 7.40. That is going to change if you change the temperature significantly. Right? So an acid is usually defined as a chemical species that can act as a proton donor, H plus donor. Alright? So an acid is basically a proton donor. We all remember that from O-level chemistry, right? Yeah, so it's coming back slowly. Yeah. Right? And of course, if an acid is a proton donor, then a base is a what? It's an acceptor. It's a proton acceptor. That's essentially what it is. The Brownstein-Lowry definition of acid and base. Right? So a strong acid is a substance that readily and almost irreversibly gives up its hydrogen ion concentration and increases hydrogen ion and increases the concentration of hydrogen ion. Okay? So we know examples of strong acids. So let me refer you back to your O-level chemistry. So you give me an example of a strong acid. HCl, all right? Phosphoric acid. Sulfuric acid. So those are strong acids, and they are referred to as strong acid because they readily and almost irreversibly. So the reaction is heading in one direction, and that direction is dissociation and is giving up of the hydrogen ion, right? So those are strong acids. And a strong base readily binds the hydrogen ion, and so those are very simple things. So these are basic things, and that's why chemistry is required to come into medicine, right? Because you're going to mix it back. And from year onwards, you're going to do a whole lot of chemistry, especially when you come into clinical medicine. Everything is going to be pretty much based on chemistry and human biology. 90% of what you're doing is going to be based on that. Right? Yeah. So, what about weak acid? We can see it reversibly donate hydrogen ion, right? So we remember this equation that we did for weaker seeds and stronger seeds. And weak base is reversibly buying hydrogen ion. So weaker seeds and bases have less effect on a hydrogen ion concentration. So we know that stronger seeds like hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid, phosphoric acid, these strong acids have very low pH. And the reason they have low pH is because they give up a lot of hydrogen ion, right? And they move the equation towards the right. Whereas strong bases will bind and move the equation towards the left. Now, but weak acids on the other hand allow the equation to go in both directions. So you have reversible binding, they bind, they give up, they bind, they give up, depending on what is happening at any particular point in time. And that's exactly how the body functions. So when we come back to how does the body regulate its pH, that's the metabolic component of it, the reason the body can do that is the body has a lot of weak acid and bases. And because of that, they are actually able to move the equation either to the right or to the left, depending on where it wants to maintain its pH. Are you with me? You understand? Alright, so I'm going to give you a quick one or two examples. Alright, so if you take a patient, for example, who has, say, diabetic ketoacidosis, alright? You all have heard about diabetic ketoacidosis? Everyone here is familiar with DKA, right? Alright, so this is a condition in diabetes where you probably are not producing enough insulin, and so as a result of that, you end up with, significant dysfunction of the organ system, and then the body begins to produce a lot of acids. Okay, a triggering factor can be, say, an infection, for example. So you end up with a diabetic foot, and then it becomes infected. An infection actually leads to production of a lot of acid, a lot of pH, right? So the patient has diabetic ketoacidosis, producing a lot of acid. Now, normally, what happens initially is because the body contains the blood and the extracellular fluid and the intracellular fluid, which we will talk about in a short while, contain a lot of weak acid and bases, and a lot of strong bases as well. So the body is producing a lot of strong acid. What happens is that the base neutralizes it. Okay? So the acid comes out, the base mops it up. Until you exhaust the mechanism, you are not going to see a significant change in your pH initially. So that's why the patient is able to compensate for a period of time, because as the acid is being produced as a result of the dysfunction, the body has this reserve system of a lot of bases that mops up the acid and tries to maintain the pH within a very narrow range. It is critical for the body to maintain the pH within a narrow range because that's where the body functions best. So every attempt to shift the pH to the left or to the right is resisted by the body by using up its reserve system of bases or acids to try to keep it back to what it is. So you begin to see a derangement when you begin to exhaust your reserve system or your system that acts. Correct, or your corrective system. And so this entire lecture is all about that. All about understanding the corrective mechanisms that the body puts in place to resist any attempt to change the pH of the body. We're together?
Great.
Are we alright? Hello? Okay, good. I like feedback. I want to be sure you're not awake, because I know some of you went to Canada last night and still sleeping, right? So most biological compounds are weak acids or bases, most of them. Alright, so let's take a look again at a few equations which I'm sure you are all familiar with as well. You probably also did this in your chemistry. HA, that's supposed to be a capital A, again an error, right? Dissociates reversibly into a hydrogen ion and an ion, right? and it has a dissociation constant. So if you solve for the dissociation constant, you find that it is your acid over your anion, the undissociated acid over your anion. So if you plot the negative logarithm of this equation, which is, and then we remember that negative logarithm of hydrogen ion, that is what is pH, okay? So your pH is equal to your pK. So what is the pK there? What is the pK there? Is it negative logarithm of the constant? Yeah, there's a constant there, right? So let's go back again. You have a pointer or something like this? No, okay, let me use it. Alright. So this is supposed to be capital A, right? Okay, this is supposed to be capital A, so you know, alright? So this is associated with reversal between hydrogen ion and an anion, right? So if you now say plot by constant, there's a constant, this actually, because this is a reversible equation, it is always accompanied by a constant. There's a constant here that drives this equation. And if you all remember your organic chemistry, everybody here did organic chemistry. Every time you have a reversible equation, it's usually on top of the reversible equation, where is the mouse? Yeah, there you go. Alright, on top of the end, it's usually a constant. And that constant can be an enzyme, it can be whatever, but it's a constant for the equation, which is a K. Alright? So when you solve for K, K is the concentration of the hydrogen ion multiplied by the concentration of the anion divided by the undissociated acid, which is the HK here. Alright? Are we still together? Okay. So if you rearrange this equation, if you rearrange the equation to solve for hydrogen ion, this is what you get. Alright? K times HA all by A minus. Are we still together? Good. Now, if you make that into a negative logarithm, which is pH is negative log this, which is now pH. Alright? PK is negative log K. Alright? And the reason you flip the equation is because you are converting it from a negative to a positive. Anybody not clear? I know for sure you did this in organic chemistry.
Years ago.
2 years ago. Yeah. Alright. So now we find that your pH is related. So if you look at this equation here, pH being equal to your pK, which is your dissociation constant, plus the log concentration of this over this, you recognize that the pH is related to the concentration of the dissociated anion to the undissociated acid. Yes? Yeah. Right here is the undissociated over the dissociated, right? The dissociated is anyone that you have the A minus. This is the anion. The breakdown of this results in this and your hydrogen ion. Okay? So this is the undissociated acid. This is a product of the undissociated acid. So this is the concentration of the undissociated over the dissociated. But because you are going to make this a negative log here, alright? And you're going to make it positive. This is just a basic rule in maths. Alright? So you're going to because you're going to make this plus, instead of getting negative log k, alright, because you are applying the negative log across the board. You are multiplying everything by negative log. and to convert it into positive, then you reverse it. Alright? So what you need to remember, or what you need to remember, or maybe we're asking your MC the question, alright, is that your pH is related to the concentration of your anions to the undissociated acid. So pH is related to the concentration of this over that. Right. So where your pH is in the NMH, with the direction of your concentration of your undissociated to your dissociated is a good indication as to where your pH is. In other words, if you have a situation where your anion, your H, is decreasing, and it's breaking up and it's decreasing, then what's going to happen to your pH? Your pH will actually increase. I understand what you mean by increase. Your acid concentration will increase, right? Your hydrogen ion concentration will increase, but your pH will actually decrease. There's an inverse relationship between hydrogen ion concentration and Alright. Weak acid will donate hydrogen ion, and a weak base will also take it off, just like strong acid and strong bases, but just in different concentration and, you know, driven by different, driven differently. Alright? So if you look at that equation, so we talk about the concept of conjugate pairs and buffers. Again, a terminology I'm sure you're all familiar with, buffers, because you need a lot of chemistry labs that you needed to use buffers, alright? So if you look at that equation where B plus hydrogen ion, you know, become BH plus, BH plus is the conjugate acid of B. Alright, the next slide might explain it a little better. That a buffer is a solution that contains a weak acid and its conjugate base, or a weak base and its conjugate acid. That's how you really define a buffer. Any solution that contains a weak acid and its conjugate base, or a weak base and its conjugate acid, is a buffer. Buffers are physiologically extremely important solutions. All right.
Those are the most effective buffers. Right? So you can put that in
your MCQ closet, okay? Those are some simple MCQ questions. Bubbles are most effective when A is whatever. They are most effective when your pH is equal to your pKa. Or when you have equal concentration of the weak acid that's conjugate base, or the weak base that's conjugate acid. Because that actually allows the solution to move better in any of the two directions. It allows the equation to move better in any of the two directions. Absolutely. If you have more of one, you are going to end up with less of the other. And so if you have to go in the other direction, then you have a problem. Right? If you are starting out with a solution. So have equal concentrations of that. Alright, so let's look at a few clinical applications. Alright? Acid bases are a huge topic. So what I'm just trying to do is try to find some key things in it for you to try to remember and to build on. Because it's a huge topic. We've skipped out all of the things and we've assumed a lot of things. Alright? So let's look at some clinical applications. I'm going to hear terminologies, and we want you to get the terminologies right from the start, because up to when certain people graduate, or you know, some doctors graduate, even graduate at postgraduate levels, many of them still don't get their terminologies right. And the reason they don't is because they just don't get it right as students, and so that errors persist with you right through your training program. So you're going to hear things like osis, okay? You all heard the term metabolic acidosis. Anybody who has not heard the term metabolic acidosis? Yeah? You have heard the term osmosis, right? Metabolic acidosis, respiratory acidosis, metabolic alkalosis, respiratory alkalosis. Why are you thinking so osis? Alright? Alright? Actually, the term osis denotes any pathologic process. Well, in this case, in this context, in the way we refer to it clinically, it refers to a process that alters an arterial pH. In this case, not about osmosis, is a different thing, okay? What you get with the term is that when you hear the term osmosis, it tells you that there is an ongoing process. Okay? Something is a dynamic process, something is happening. Yeah, pathological process. Okay? So when we say metabolic acidosis, what you're talking about is that there is ongoing production of hydrogen ion. Okay? It's ongoing. And in a little while you see why the term is important. So any disorder that tends to lower arterial pH is referred to as acidosis. Okay? I'm not saying whether it's metabolic or respiratory. I'm just using the word acidosis. I'm not defining or classifying it whether metabolic or respiratory. But if you have any condition that lowers your arterial pH, that condition is a kind of acidosis. And acidosis could be metabolic, or it could be respiratory, or it could be both. Okay. So if the primary condition is of metabolic origin, then it's metabolic acidosis. If the primary condition is of respiratory origin that lowers the pH, then it's respiratory acidosis. Does it make sense? And the reverse is true for alkalosis. Any condition that raises arterial pH, okay, is an alkalosis, an alkaloid. It can be respiratory or it could be metabolic. If the process is driven by metabolic conditions, then it's metabolic alkalosis. If the process is driven by respiratory condition, then it is respiratory alkalosis. Once you get that straight, shop, you're fine, you're good to go. Alright? So I'm going to come back to that. Right? This is what we just talked about. And I'll come back to the slide that I just made. Now, if the disorder affects bicarbonate primarily, it is referred to as metabolic. Alright? Now, maybe I'm just introducing bicarbonate, like, couple of the blue to you. I assume what you guys know. You're familiar with it. Okay? As I said, you skipped a lot of things, you assumed a lot of things. Alright? Bicarbonate is one of the primary or perhaps the most important metabolic buffer in blood. Any condition that primarily lowers bicarbonate will lead to what? A decrease in arterial pH, right? And that condition will be referred to as what? Metabolic acidosis. And there are many ways you can lower bicarbonate. If you produce a lot of hydrogen ion, if you produce a lot of acid, and the bicarbonate has to keep mopping up the acid, and the acid you are producing overwhelms the bicarbonate in your system, what do you think is going to happen to your pH? And that condition is what? Metabolic acidosis. Right? And so when we ask you, give me an example of metabolic acidosis, all you really need to do is to think about those conditions that lead to what? Increased production of hydrogen ion. Right? Yeah, we'll come back to some of the causes a little. So we just want to get the terminology straight. Okay? So if the condition leads to bicarb decreasing, and bicarb is decreasing because it has to do more work to mop up all of this hydrogen ion you're throwing at it, wherever it is coming from, whether it's an infected foot, or whether it's a heart that is not pumping well, and so the body is not getting enough blood, and then the body now switches to anaerobic metabolism, because it's not getting enough blood and enough oxygen, alright? And it switches to anaerobic metabolism, and we know that the byproduct of anaerobic metabolism is what? Lactic acid and pyruvic acid. Okay, those are acid. Or maybe the kidneys are not working, and so the kidneys cannot clear all of these toxins, and so they accumulate in blood, okay? And they are acidic. Or the liver is not working, and so the liver cannot metabolize properly, and it's ending up with intermediary metabolic products which are very acidic, okay? And the bicarb in the body has to mop up all of this acid because it is attempting to keep the pH in a range so that the body can function, so you are using up the bicarb, okay? And so what you're going to end up with, as you're using up the bicarb, when you overwhelm that bicarb system, your pH is going to what? It's going to fall. Right? And that is what metabolic acidosis. All of those processes that I just talked about are all common conditions that cause metabolic acidosis. Make sense? Okay. If the disorder primarily affects PaCO2, that's your carbon dioxide, it is referred to what? As respiratory acidosis. Carbon dioxide is what is often referred to as volatile acid or non-organic acid. Alright, so you have two types of acid in the body, volatile acid and non-volatile acid. Alright, so because carbon dioxide combines with water in the presence of what's the name of the enzyme again? Carbonic acid, which is a very important enzyme in the body. It's all over, it's in the lungs, it's in the kidneys, it's in the red blood cells, it's in the eyes, it's everywhere. Okay, because that process is always taking place. So carbon dioxide combines with water in the presence of carbonic acid to form H2CO3. In presence of carbonic anhydrase to form H2CO3. And then it dissociates, depending on temperature, into what? Hydrogen ion and bicarbonate. That is a very important process that takes place. So, and the reverse is true, that when bicarbonate traps that hydrogen ion that has been introduced into the body, and the bicarb goes after it traps it, that bicarbonate plus that hydrogen ion forms what? Carbonic acid, right? And that carbonic acid breaks down into what? Carbon dioxide and what? You exhale it. Alright, so this is the mechanism by which the body regulates acid and base. Okay? If you are unable to blow off that carbon dioxide, alright? Or if you are producing too much carbon dioxide, and then you think about that condition that leads to increased production of carbon dioxide. Yes, but that's chronic. Remember, I'm talking about the acute condition. You are correct. Alright? Well, think about a disease condition. Exercise, alright? But when you exercise, what normally happens? You increase your breathing, right? That's why when you run, you breathe fast. You lose a lot of carbon dioxide, your minimum ventilation goes up. Alright? So think about any clinical condition that leads to increase in metabolism. Thyroid storm. Have you seen a patient with thyroid toxicosis? Not yet, you're still seeing one. Alright? Thyroid storm. When you have a thyroid toxicosis, the hands are flopping because the, you know what the primary body thyroid hormone does? It's the main metabolic hormone of the body. So it drives everything. Okay? And so there's increased everything. Your heart is beating fast, your temperature goes up, you are fidgeting, everything is, you're burning up. Fever. Alright? Certain drugs can cause what is known as malignant hypothermia. All these conditions lead to increased production of carbon dioxide in the body. And if you are unable to get rid of that carbon dioxide, what do you think is going to happen? Your pH is going to fall. Because that carbon dioxide will become acid on the cell. Okay? That's why you are watching the movie waiting to exhale. That's why I say when you're begging somebody begs your intelligence. Okay? I say take a deep breath and exhale. Alright? That's where all of that comes from. Alright? Okay, so let's move quickly. So we introduce another suffix. We talk about osis, now we're going to talk about emia. The term emia is used to denote the net effect of primary processes and secondary compensatory physiologic responses on arterial blood. Okay, let me explain that. So many things are happening at the same time, okay? Let's go back to our diabetic patient who is producing a lot of acid from the infected food, okay? That food is dying and there's a lot of anaerobic metabolism in there. It's not getting enough blood, okay? And so it's producing a lot of byproducts of metabolism. And that acid is coming into the blood. Right? The blood has to confront this hydrogen ion. This is similar to, you know what it's similar to? It's like as if I put a bottle of hydrochloric acid, put up a drip in you, and I start running the hydrochloric acid. That's exactly the same thing that you have. Okay? When you have an infection, you have to produce an acid. So whether I'm giving you exogenously or it's coming endogenously, the result is the same. Okay? So this acid is coming into the blood. The body confronts it with its buffers, and the first in line is the bicarbonate. Bicarbonate mixes up this hydrogen ion. The bicarbonate mixes it up, clamps it down, but it has to do something with it. Clamps it down, H joins up with HCO3, it becomes H2CO3, which is still acid. And H2CO3 breaks down. If the temperature is right, breaks down into CO2 and water, and you have to blow out the CO2. And that's what I've just described here is a patient that has metabolic acidosis with respiratory compensation. Does it make sense? So that's metabolic acidosis with what? Respiratory compensation. So that's how the body compensates. So a private process. Now, while all of this is going on, I take some blood from this patient and I check what the acid level is. I look for the pH in blood. The pH that I see in blood is the net result of the primary process and the secondary compensation. All of everything that is happening, the result that I get in blood is the net effect of all the processes. Does it make sense? So if the bicarbonate has been overwhelmed, you don't really have much bicarbonate, what do you think will happen to the pH? Does it make sense? If I tie something around your nose and lock down your mouth so that you can't blow out the CO2, okay? What do you think is going to happen to the pH? Alright? So if you are hypoventilating for any reason, that is, you cannot blow out the CO2, you cannot compensate that. Alright? Or if I overwhelm your metabolic system, use up all your bicarb, or almost use up all your bicarb, because I'm pouring too much acid. The acid is coming fast. Much more than the body can produce bicarb. That will exhaust your bicarb, and your pH will fall. And that will result in severe metabolic acidosis. In this case, you have a primary metabolic acidosis with what? Respiratory compensation.
So, if we're looking at the net of this primary process, we're going to have a respiratory acidosis.
Correct. We haven't addressed respiratory, we're just using the metabolic as the easiest to describe. Yeah.
And then if it does compensate, we can have a respiratory.
Correct. When you say acidosis, you have to be specific. What type of acidosis?
In mind, I'm thinking that this is supposed to be first response from the purpose to the metabolic acidosis, not the acidosis itself.
No, the pathology is the primary part. The pathology is a metabolic acidosis. Correct? I'm giving you a clinical situation where the basic pathology. Alright, is a metabolic acidosis. In other words, I'll give you a clinical situation. Say somebody has a gangrenous foot, a diabetic patient with a gangrenous foot. The foot is dying. And when that foot is dying, it produces a lot of lactic acid. Because that's it, or it's a dying foot. Alright? And this lactic acid is getting into the blood. Alright? So treat it as acid, H plus. So H plus is pouring into the blood from the foot. Right? This was a person who was normally fine. If before the whole process started, you checked the pH of this person, it was 7.40, it was a normal pH. However, since he or she became ill and have this acid pouring into his blood, okay, you went back and checked the pH and you realize now the pH is 7.20 or 7.10. So the pH has dropped. But when you check the PCO2 as well, the PCO2 is 20 or 25. Alright? We haven't talked about CO2 yet. So what you see here is that the pH is low, the bicarbonate is low, and the CO2 is low. Because you blow it out, it's trying to blow it out. It's just that the person is trying to compensate you, but the only problem is that the system is overwhelmed.
And it's compensatory.
The compensatory, you're going to try to describe what the response to the new partner. So because of exact what you're doing is why we will not see that terminology used, but a correct in the true sense of it. There's an insult, there is a primary response, really, but we will not see them use the word primary response. Alright? We just call it a response. And then there's a secondary compensatory. The net result is what you see in the world. That's what you see. Okay, quickly. So metabolic acidosis is defined as a primary decrease in bicarbonate concentration. Alright? A primary decrease in bicarbonate concentration is metabolic acidosis. Several pathologic processes can initiate metabolic acidosis, and they can largely be divided into three main groups. There are those processes that lead to the consumption of bicarbonate by strong non-volatile acid. I will give you many examples of that. Alright? Anything that will lead to the consumption of your bicarbonate by a strong non-volatile acid. So we say if you have an infected food, if you have heart failure and the heart is unable to pump enough blood to the body and thereby the body now switches to anaerobic metabolism. If you have kidney failure, if you have liver failure, if you have an infection all over your body, all of these things will result in the production of non-volatile acid. And it will consume like acid because the body will attempt to maintain its pH. So you're going to use up your bicarbonate in doing that. All right? And that is metabolic acidosis. That's one major rule. The next major rule, renal or GI wasting of bicarbonate. Right? You can have bicarb loss, like diarrhea, like prolonged diarrhea will lead to metabolic acidosis because you're losing the bicarb, because the GI is full of bicarbonate. There's a lot of bicarbonate in your gastrointestinal system. Right? And these are where all the reserves are in the body. There are too many areas the body has reserves of bicarbonate in the GI and in the renal system. The renal system doesn't store it, but the renal system has the capacity to produce it. Okay? Produce it because it has a lot of carbonic anhydrase in the brush borders of the kidneys. And so it can combine water and CO2 and make bicarb. There's a factory there. Red blood cells. So if you are losing it in your GI, you're having a lot of diarrhea, you'll be losing bicarbonate. Or if you're losing it in your kidney, all right, and there are renal tubular acidosis, which is a condition, there are several types of renal tubular acidosis. It's type 1, type 2, type 4. Renal tubular acidosis, where you lose a lot of bicarb because the body is not able to reabsorb the bicarb that is filtered in the kidney. All of those will lead to metabolic acidosis. So those are just two. Or if you rapidly dilute extracellular fluid with bicarbonate-free fluid, I'm giving you a lot of IV fluid. All right, give me a lot of IV fluid, and it doesn't contain bicarbonate. If I give you too much of it, you may start to end up with acidosis because I'm diluting your bicarbonate. Okay, that's iatrogenic, and it's not a common cause. But the first two, especially the first one, are the common cause. Okay, a fall in bicarbonate without a proportionate reduction in arterial CO2 will lead to a decrease in pH. That's all we've been talking about, right? That when your bicarbonate starts to fall, what happens to your CO2? What do you expect your CO2 to do? To fall as well. If your CO2 doesn't fall, alright, and your bicarbonate is falling, your pH is going to drop rapidly. Response to your metabolic acid. There's no respiratory response to it. You cannot compensate it. Correct. You can end up also with respiratory acidosis. But we don't want to confuse you by giving you a mixed acidosis so that we try to keep it very simple. Alright, so how does the pulmonary system compensate? The pulmonary compensatory response produces what? A marked increase in ventilation. So when you see somebody who has metabolic acidosis, what do? They breathe fast and they breathe hard. Because they're trying to blow out the CO2. And that is what is known as what? So you don't have to memorize it. You can work with it. Alright? So I think I'm probably going to skip this because of time. Differential diagnosis of metabolic acidosis. Can be gap metabolic acidosis or normal. Alright, so let's go to respiratory acidosis. Respiratory acidosis is a primary increase in PaCO2. That's what is respiratory acidosis. Because CO2 is up, that's respiratory acidosis. Normal CO2 is what? 40. Yeah, it's 40, but normal range 35 to 40. There are 36 to 40. But the ideal CO2 is 40. That is milliliters of mercury. Okay? Measure the milliliters of mercury. Alright, we look at that equation which we have talked about a lot today. Water will combine with CO2 to call carbonic anhydrates. In the presence of carbonic anhydrates, leading to carbonic acid formation, which can break down into hydrogen ion and bicarbonate, and that reaction goes both ways, depending on where and what is happening. All right, if there's metabolic acidosis, then it starts here. This combines with this, from this, in presence of this, it becomes this and that. Okay? So, alright? So, so the other way around, if you want to produce more bicarbonate, it goes this way. So, it depends on what is happening. The body has the ability to change this situation one way or the other. Alright? But the good thing is that PaCO2, which is the partial pressure of carbon dioxide, represents the balance between carbon dioxide production and carbon dioxide elimination. Right? So when you measure the carbon dioxide in blood, what you see is a representation of the balance between production and elimination. And the equation for that, you will remember this, is that PaCO2 is equal to CO2 production over alveolar ventilation. Alright? Your PaCO2 is the net result of your CO2 production and your alveolar ventilation.
Net
productions over your net loss. If I'm producing a lot of CO2 and I'm also able to eliminate it, everything is okay. The problem is, if I'm producing a lot and I'm not able to eliminate it, then my CO2 is going to go up and then my pH is going to go down. Hypoventilation. Right? That's known as hypoventilation. Alright, these are some causes of increased PaCO2. Alright? CO2 production, increased temperature, increased thyroid hormone activities, decreased alveolar ventilation, hypoventilation. Hypoventilation can be caused by things like drugs. Okay? People die from opioid overdose. You know why people die from opioid overdose? When people take heroin, morphine, cocaine. What do you think happens to them? It depresses their what? Respiratory system. It depresses their respiratory center. They hypoventilate, their CO2 goes. Their oxygen goes down, they can play, they develop respiratory acidosis, their blood pressure falls, and the cycle goes up, and then the heart stops. That's what happens. Alright? All people have head injury, severe head injury, like severe traumatic brain injury. They are not able to breathe properly, and they increase CO2 production, and cycles. Right. Neuromuscular disorders, myasthenia gravis, Guillain-Barré syndrome, all the various neuromuscular disorders. Eventually, if it's severe enough, it can affect your ability to breathe and have a problem. Chest wall abnormality, people that have severe type of scoliosis. Have you ever seen people with scoliosis? Really bad scoliosis. And really, really twisted. What it does, it compresses the lungs. Alright, you get restrictive breathing, and then you are putting a lot of CO2 and you cannot eliminate it. Pleural abnormalities like a pneumothorax. Okay, people who develop pneumothorax, lung cannot expand, alright, and so you cannot eliminate the CO2. Or large pleural effusions, or lung parenchyma disease with the destructions of the lung tissue. Right? Interstitial lung disease, severe form, all different kind of diseases, pathologies that will affect the parenchyma of the lung itself, starts to destroy, and one of them we had very recently, just coming out of a pandemic caused by what? COVID. And one of the things that COVID did was what? Destroyed lungs. And the lungs can no longer do what it's primarily responsible for. Bring oxygen and eliminate CO2. Right? So all of these will lead to increased CO2 production. So severe ARDS, which is a terminal stage of COVID, will lead to hypoxia and hypercalcemia. ARDS.
What happened?
Acute respiratory distress.
What
airway obstruction, right? Lung parenchymal disease. Right, very quickly, metabolic alkalosis is primary increase in plasma bicarbonate. Right? Associated with deficiency in sodium chloride and extracellular fluid depletion. And these are known as chloride sensitive. So there are two types of metabolic alkalosis. And remember what metabolic alkalosis. What is the definition of metabolic alkalosis? There are two main types, those that are referred to as chloride sensitive and chloride resistant. Right. The far common type is chloride sensitive. The commonest cause of metabolic acidosis is extracellular fluid depletion. That's the commonest cause of metabolic acidosis. Extracellular fluid. Alright. Chloride resistance is usually associated with mineralocorticoid activity. Increased mineralocorticoid activity will lead to chloride resistant metabolic alkalosis. Alright, so this basically tells you some of the causes of metabolic alkalosis. Under chloride sensitive, GI from vomiting, from gastric drainage, chloride diarrhea, venous adenoma, all of these will cause metabolic alkalosis. Remember I told you that diarrhea will cause what? Metabolic acidosis. And vomiting will cause what? Metabolic alkalosis. And you know why vomiting will cause metabolic acidosis? Because your hydrogen ion is weird. It's gone. Your bicarbonate is weird. It's gone. And that's why the pH of the fluid in the stomach is what? Small. But the pH of the fluid in the small intestine is high. That's where your bicarb is. And it can have the fluoride in the stomach. Alright? So people on diuretics, all of these will cause metabolic alkalosis. Alright? These are examples of fluoride resistance, usually due to hyperaldosteronism, primary hyperaldosteronism, or secondary hyperaldosteronism, massive blood transfusion, alkaline administration, hypercalcemia, also known sometimes as alkaline syndrome. All of these will cause metabolic alkalosis. Alright, finally, respiratory alkalosis. So, what would be respiratory alkalosis? Hyperventilation, a low PCO2. Okay? A low PCO2 is very pretty alkalosis. Okay? Alright, some common causes would include central stimulation, anxiety. For example, exams are coming and you're not studying. Alright? You check your blood pH. As soon as you pick the exam paper and you look at it, you remember you don't know anything there when I'm studying it. What do you have to your blood pH? All for that. Going up because we're going to blow out all the CO2, right? And when you finish blowing out the CO2, you're going to start to what? Be like a day. Sir, I'm not feeling good. Oh, but I'm going to just sit in the place of spinning. See that a lot. Peripheral stimulation, pulmonary disease, iatrogenic ventilator induced. These are all causes of